So we computed various expectation values of the pi, kx, and related things in the last class. We now want to use that to understand what the strings get. Okay? So how are we going to do that? Well, let's start with simplest examples. Well, first let me remind you of the formula we used in the game. It's that e to the power I k I of yi product over I expectation value is equal to the number of yij product I less than j to alpha prime k I. Here is the right last payment. Okay. Now let's apply this to the study of three tachyon scattering. So the three tachyon scattering, according to our general rules, has we've got three C operators. So let's say a C operator at Y1, a C operator at Y2, and a C operator at Y3. Times e to the power I k1 at y1, k1 to x at y1, e to the power I k2 to x at y2, and e to the power I k3 to x at y3. Okay. Now we want to understand what the expectation value is. Well, the conformal field theory is deduced from the conformal field theory on C's of the conformal theory of X's. We can do the expectation value separately. And this part you've already seen. It's y1, 2, y2, 3, y1, 3. We've computed. So that's the part, the C's. Now let's compute the thing with the X's. Okay? So the thing with the X's goes as follows. We've got e to the power, so we get y1, 2 to the power equal alpha prime into k1 dot k2, y2, 3 into 2 alpha prime k2 dot k3, and y1, 3 into 2 alpha prime into k1 dot k2. Okay. Now, remember that from general principles, all three vertex operators are fixed at particular points, y1, y2, y3. Right? We could choose these points to be anything, but in this simple calculation, I've not chosen them to be anything particular. Get the three arbitrary points, and then, I mean, it's a consistency check on our procedure that this amplitude should not depend on the insertion points from the device. So at first, it sounds crazy. How can it work? This depends on the momenta. But then when you think about it, it works. And how? Remember, k1 dot k2 is equal to k1 plus k1. The whole thing squared minus k1 squared minus k2 squared. Now, k1 plus k2, the whole thing squared, is the same as k3 squared. It's negative. So each of these is given by the marginal value of the marginal tangent. Okay? So, the mass of the tachyon is k squared. The mass of the tachyon is minus 1 there, right? K squared is 1 by 3, right? Okay? So this is equal to minus 1 by 3. Because we get 1 by alpha prime minus 1 by alpha prime minus 1. Okay? And this had a 2. This is correct. The formula is correct to that. The 2. And so, we conclude that y1, 2 is raised to the power minus 1. Similarly, y2, 3 is raised to the power minus 1, y3, 1 is raised to the power minus 1, and we can cancel. This is just what you're using for 1. Okay. Now, there's an additional point here that in this particular example is more or less trivial. It's the amount of additional factor of 2. But it's sort of important in more generality, so I'll make it. And that's it. Look, now we have three objects of momentum, k1, k2, and k3. And we place them at some points y1, y2, y3. And we said that, well, it doesn't matter what these points y1, y2, y3 are, because we can choose them to be anything by the appropriate Mobius transformation, the appropriate unfixed conformal transformation that leaves a boundary on J. But, you see, any variable of change that acts in a one-to-one fashion on the boundary cannot change the relative ordering of points. Okay? So, given a particular ordering, okay, now the way that we need to do calculations is to regard the worksheet of the open string as the upper half of it. So the upper half plane is conformally related, is conformally transformable into the disk. Okay? And you identify points at infinity. So then this becomes a boundary and you see that reference to the disk. So the points that we put, let's say, y1, y2, and y3, instead of having a linear ordering, what we think about these points having a cyclic. Okay? So it's this cyclical ordering of y1, y2, y3 on the boundary of the worksheet that cannot be changed by quadratic transformations. Okay? So, if we want to sum over all particular ways of inserting a vertex operator, we should sum over all cyclical orderings. And then for a given cyclical ordering, we can choose this y1, y3 to be anything we want. Is this clear? This is fine. Coordinate transformations that are unfixed by a case fixing procedure that allow us to take y1, y2, y3 to anything have to be one-to-one transformations and therefore cannot change the relative ordering of points on the boundary. Is this clear? Okay, so you have to, that has to be summed over explicitly. Now, since in this particular simple case, the amplitude did not care was not a function of k1, k2, k3. So if 1 will become perhaps 2, we're not doing these calculations at the level that you track such factors and drop in delta functions and things stuff. So for this particular calculation, we would not care very much. But it will soon become important in various other things, you know? And it will also become important in this calculation when we generalize a calculation in a particular way. So let me immediately tell you about that. Okay? So now generalization goes as follows. So far we've been talking about open strings living on the strip. Okay? With Neumann bounded conditions at both ends of the strip. Okay? Now, once you have boundary conditions, you've got some special boundary points, you might, you know, various considerations that we dealt with tell us what the propagation of the theory has been in the past. That we can't change easily, since frame very tiny for you. However, you might want to add new boundary degrees of freedom. New degrees of freedom that live just at the boundary of the world. The question of how you can add new boundary degrees of freedom in a way that preserves conformal invariance and all the other good properties of string theory is an intricate and interesting question. Well, we were not trying to give a thorough analysis of that at all. All we're going to do is to make very... all we're going to do is to make a very particular choice. Okay? There are other ways to do it, and that gets into more complicated what I call boundary states. String theory. At some point in our course, I think research will be done this. But at the moment, we're going to talk about a very trivial set of boundary degrees. The boundary degrees of freedom, okay, living in a particular vector space, there is finite n dimensions. Okay? So there's a finite dimensional vector space living in each boundary. Okay? And we work in some basis of this vector space. So there's some inner product of this vector space, inner space. And we work in some basis, some orthogonal basis, in which the basis vectors we call so the basis vectors are, you know, column 1, 0, 0, 0,
0100 and so on.
Okay. And we will choose the Hamiltonian for these boundary degrees of freedom. The evolution operator of the boundary degrees of freedom to be true. Okay? Which means that along any given boundary, the boundary degrees of freedom don't change. Okay? Basically what I'm saying is then, is that the open strings in the picture come in different flavors. The flavors are labeled by one index I that runs from 1 to n, where n is anything. Okay? One index I that runs from 1 to n on the left boundary, and one index I that runs from 1 to n on the right boundary. Okay? So, now our open strings on the strip, in addition to being labeled by, you know, what we've got is the full Hilbert space that we obtained by quantizing these open strings, is specified by a vector in the tensor product of the Hilbert space we had before, namely the oscillators in the zero modes, and this n squared dimensional Hilbert space, which tells us about the boundary degrees of freedom on the left and the right. Okay? So you can think of it as some matrix. Okay? N cross N matrix times whatever we had before. Okay? Think of it as N squared different species of open strings. You've got N squared different species of open strings. Okay? The species does not change in evolution. Okay? But that changes in interactions of things. Okay? Each species behaves identical with every other figure. Is this clear? Okay? Now, this, though we may not see it very systematically in each thing, turns out to be consistent generalization. It's one of a much larger of there's a folk theory one can build up consistent boundary states or boundary interactions one can put in virtually a string. I won't stop to try to build that okay at this point. We just look at this as one example of something that's more or less trivial and therefore when you look at it carefully more or less clearly consistent as a generalization of the boundary this normal condition the open string. Okay. So now the important thing is that states of the open space, and then vertex operators, are labeled not just by the vertex operator labelings that we've got before, the pi, I, k, x, and derivatives and so on, but also by the n cross n matrix. Okay? So vertex operators a fixed tachyon will have a C of Y1, a lambda 1, to some A of N. And E to the pi, I, K, I. Okay. Now, remember that our evolution rule was that an index cannot change at all. Okay? So we've got an open string, and its index cannot change along the boundary. However, it comes and interacts with two other open strings. So the index along here is conserved. The index along here is conserved. The index along here is conserved. Okay? Now these open strings are replaced by their vertex operator. What does that tell us about any computation involving the insertion of three or more vertex operators? It tells us that you have to put, in addition to what you had before, you also have to put in the trace of lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, going in cyclic order. Is this clear?
Okay? So, now let's recompute the three tachyons scattering amplitude in this large theory where there are these new boundary degrees of freedom. Okay? So let's do that. So we've already seen, we can get the answer 1 from the matter part. Okay? For any particular. So, suppose we had lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3 associated with e to the power I k x1, e to the power I k x2, and e to the power k1x, k2x. These are our three values. Now, we've already seen that irrespective of what ordering we choose, okay, we get one from the matter part and matter and gross part from the amplitude. But there are two different sizes of ordering that we've already seen. So, determinant 3. Or 1, 3, and 2. So, these two different cyclical orderings. They don't give us equal contributions from the lambdas. Because one of them gives us trace of lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. And the second one gives us trace of lambda 1, lambda 3, lambda 2. And these are not the same. Okay? So if we wanted to do, we could write this as, for instance, trace of the anticommutator of lambda 1, lambda 2 to lambda 3 times 1. That's our final answer for three tachyons scattering amplitudes. Okay? Where the tachyons are labeled by their n cross I naming sort of matrix, vertex operator plus the momentum. And the amplitude happens to be the vector of the momentum. Is this clear? Okay? Good. Now, we're going to do another three-point function calculation. This time of scattering of two tachyons to the gate. Okay? What's the physical interpretation of this calculation? Somebody. If I take two tachyons of scattering with the gate worker, what will it help me learn? Whether the tachyon is charged, and if so, how it's charged under this gate. Now, of course, now everything in the theory carries these n cross n instances. The tachyons and the gate. So, it's a natural guess, as you see, that it's correct, that the gate bosons are going to be non-abelian. Okay? And that the tachyons will be non-abelian tachyons. Okay? But let's start seeing this. So, now what we want to do is to compute so the three operators that we have, let's call the gauge boson operator number 1. So we have e to the power k1 dot x. And then it's associated with the polarization vector e dot del x. And this guy comes with its matrix thing lambda. Then we have e to the power I k2 dot x. This is associated with nothing else. And e to the power I k3 dot x. Again associated with K2 and K3 are the two tachyon vertex operators. Well, of course, that's all. Polarization. The matrix is lambda 2 lambda
3.
The derivative along the law. Yes. Okay. So now let's, and of course, there's also the C field. Each of these are once again going to be prefixed. Okay, now let's
compute the let's compute the scattering amplitude, the expectation value of these vertex operators in this. So once again, we're going to have two orderings. We'll have the ordering, let's say, 1, 2, 3, and the ordering 1, 3, 2. Okay, so let's do the calculation first for the first. So that's the calculation for 1, 2, 3. Okay, firstly for the C fields, that's simple, it's 1, y1, 2, y1, 3, y2, 3. Okay, and that will be common for both orderings, you know, there. We'll have that outside. Okay, now let's also do the calculation of this lambda, so that's very simple. So the first guy gets, oh yeah, I'll try to do the calculation for both orderings simultaneously. You run out of board space, okay. That's fine. The first guy will get a trace of lambda 1, lambda, well, okay, if we're taking our, we have to decide which way we're taking our traces, let's say we take our traces back. Clockwise. I'm not sure what the usual convention is, but let's say that we will take up traces this way. Get a matrix is 1 back. Okay? So lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. And this guy, of course, and there'll be something multiplying it. This guy will have a trace of lambda 1, lambda 3, lambda 2. Now then we have to figure out one multiplier, is it? In these cases. And what multiplies in each of these cases comes from the max. So let's work that out. Alright. So, good. So, let's work out what we get by contracting this guy, and this guy. In order to do that, we need the rule that we developed last class. The rule that we developed last class helped us deal with insertions of this delta x. So the rule said, contract the exponential such that the delta x wasn't there, and add an additional factor for delta x. Okay? So first let's do the contraction of the delta x, the exponential such that the delta x wasn't there, and then we divide with the additional factor. So let's look at the term that we've got, that's y1. Then we have y1 to the power of 1. Well, it's 2 alpha prime k1 dot k2. Now, once again, k1 dot k2, 2 k1 dot k2, is k3 squared minus k1 squared minus k2 squared. But, k1 squared is 0. And k3 squared is equal to k2 squared. Okay? So, we get 0. There's a 2k1 dot k2, which is k3 squared minus k1 squared minus k2 squared. K1 squared is 0, k2 squared is equal to 0. We can see. Okay? Similarly, we get y13 to the power. The y23 is the following. For y23, we get 2k1 squared. So we get k1 squared minus k2 squared minus k3 squared. K1 squared is 0, but k2 squared and k3 squared are each 1 by alpha. Okay? So this becomes minus. So from the insertion we get if you remember the formula, it says you get 1 over, there's a number which we won't keep that overall number. So we have 1 over y1 minus y2, which is k2, plus one over y1 minus y3, okay, into k3. The general formula was the check where this guy's intercepted. This guy's intercepted at a point 1. Okay, so you take yi minus yj for all other intersections and have the k of the other guy on top. And then that guy is going to be locked in with the polarization tensor. And that guy is going to be locked in with the polarization tensor that appears up here. In this case, can be vector indices.
to commutate a lambda 3 up to a possible saddle. Each of you to go home and think this minus sign through carefully in your mind. Okay? But the net result is that these two orderings contribute to the relative minus. Okay? That's the thing that's really important. That's what makes this commutator rather than the anti-commutator we have. In particular, suppose there had been no polarization tensors. Suppose that these lambdas are too trivial. Okay, where is the minus to upside, by the way? From K32 is minus K23. Okay? So suppose if lambdas have been trivial, this would have just been zero. So it would have been the statement that the tachyon is uncharged under the gauge book. Okay? Well, in the general case, it's not trivial. But we also see how this thing, you see, this is the polarization, the matrix structure of the two tachyons. It's a commutator that appears. Okay? The commutator that appears multiplied by the matrix of the gauge boson. Now this is in fact a statement that the tachyon is interacting with the gauge boson exactly like a minimally coupled adjoint scalar interacts with the matrix. Why is that? Let's write down the Lagrangian for minimally coupled adjoints. The Lagrangian for minimally coupled adjoint scalar is trace of del mu phi d mu phi times d mu phi. So where do we get the two tachyons and one gauge boson interaction from? It comes from one of these d mu's having the AB. And the term of that is A mu commutator phi times phi trace. And this one has the order. Okay? You see that this is exactly the same as this lambda structure. You know, where we put the commutator doesn't matter under the trace. It would be a commutator for any two of these. It's the same matrix anyways. Whether we call it 1 and 2 or just the fact that we've got two cyclical orbits with a relative minus sign. That's the embedded thing. Okay? So this is exactly this color structure. This derivative here is the fact that the amplitude has a k. Okay? And the fact that this derivative contracts with the AU is the fact that the k contracts with the polarization. So, we've got a little more detail than we have here. You see that the Feynman rule of sketching amplitude that follows from this interaction matrix is precisely this, some factor. Okay? So we concluded that the open string theory, it's really seen very much like open string theory has non-abelian gauge bosons in it, and that the tachyon field is charged like an adjoint scalar under these non-abelian. Now, though we worked it out specifically for the tachyon, okay, every field in the problem, apart from the gauge boson itself, but every field in the problem enters as an n cross n matrix. Okay? So it's plausible that every field in the problem is charged in the adjoint of this gauge. Okay? So, what I'm saying is that if you work out the first excitation state, for instance, two copies of that scattering against the tachyon, once again you'll find a similar state. Which will tell you that basically all states of the theory are charged in the adjoint of this UNB2. Okay?
The one phase that's special in this regard is the gate post sum itself. It's special because it will give you all the interactions. If our interpretation is correct, it should give you the scattering amplitudes that follow from the interactions of gate post sum itself with itself in the Young interaction. Okay. So now I'm going to leave. So something that's interesting to do is to calculate the three point scattering of three gate bosons. Okay, I'm going to leave that as the exercise. Okay, it's more of a system. You know, you just have to do all this stuff again and again. It's one new element is that in the rule for contraction of these derivatives, you remember there were also the oscillators, effective oscillators. You just have one derivative. No, there's nothing for it to contract against. We didn't have to use that. So now we have three derivatives. Okay, so there will be oscillator contractions pairwise, in addition to taking the term that is just this piece for all three derivatives. Okay? So the structure of the amplitude should be clear. There will be one term when you take this piece for all three derivatives, which will be cubic in one. And then there will be three other terms, which will be linear in one. Where you take this term for one of the two derivatives and the oscillators for the other. Is that clear? You know what I'm talking about? You know what I mean when I say the oscillators? You remember what our rule was for contracting these derivatives? There's a part that contracts as if the exponentials were there. That's what I'm calling the oscillators. You can contract therefore only against other derivatives. And there's a part that has background value that we will keep intact. The background value is a linear domain. Okay? So the term where you keep all three background values will be cubic in momentum. And the term where you keep one momentum, the two, then x is contracting, will be linear. There will be four terms. Okay, because of the oscillators you can choose, there are three ways of choosing which way is contracting. Okay? So there will be four terms you have to keep track of. I'll just quote you the result from which is.
Reduces the gauge area very low energies, but has additional interactions that
are not there in the minimally coupled. Yes, correct. So this term, look it up, is reproduced from a term of Lagrangian which is proportional to alpha prime into F mu alpha F alpha. So we'll keep linear pieces for two of these Fs, and the linear pieces from all three Fs. Yeah, just the linear pieces from all three Fs, and that will give us these Fs. Why is that? Let's see. So this is. Okay, let's note. This is effectively del mu a nu and del mu a nu. And similarly, del alpha, del mu a alpha minus del alpha a. Okay, so three such terms. And why do we get this structure of complexion? Let's see.
And try to convince yourself that what you get from here
is exactly what you expect from the ordinary Angular function. And what you get from here is some higher order term in string. By the way, this higher order term is not inconsistent with string theory, reproduced gauge theory, and low energies. Because if all derivatives, all landscapes are large compared to alpha prime, this term is much smaller compared to this. See, because it has two additional derivatives and one additional power of alpha compared to this term. So in the derivative expansion, in the limit where landscapes are large, in units of alpha prime, this term is a press compared to this. At least naively. Okay? So, such terms are there, but they matter only for configurations that vary on length scales or on energy scales or on the string scale. If we're comparing the length scale is large compared to string scale, where energy is low compared to string scale, that term is negligible compared to the vector. Is this clear? Okay, so the lower energies you get back gauge theory, but of course our connections are high energies. That's very easy in string scale. This is a simple thing. Is this clear?
You would definitely be worried if this was a field theory.
If this was a field theory, yes, you would be worried if this was a field theory. But we know string theory is fantastic finite. Yes. So you see, this is not the only term. If it was the only term, the Lagrangian would be bad. But it's, this is the effective action that comes from some, you know, something over all of string theory. But this is one term of the effective action. The first effective action is much larger thing. And we have independent ways of understanding that string theory is very finite. So those issues aren't an issue. It's, you know, basically the same. When we started in closed string theory, we had the gravity, and then we had higher derivative interactions with that graviton. That would be even worse than the gravity, the Lagrangian. But the whole theory is finite. You see, it's particular regularization that makes sense, which if you expand it out in the lattice spacing, and increasing effective time spaces, right? Increasing higher energy terms. The whole thing is nicely taken. You know, just as an analogy, it's not a very good one for string theory, but anyway, if you do something like e to the power minus del squared m a squared, this is a factor that suppresses high energy. But if you expand it out in a power series in A, it will look worse and worse as you go to higher and higher. That's roughly what's going on.
But that would be a very non-local term.
That would be a very non-local term. Yes, it's certainly not easy to make consistent theories of gravity, special gravity, by hand, doing something. So string theory manages it in a very beautiful and intricate way without doing something crude like that. But just if you want a rough analogy, this is the image. And string theory is not local at that. So, I mean, it's not local at string theory. But at least there's no precise sense in which it is. The strings are big objects. String case, that's fine. Okay. Also, you know, what you mean by locality in a theory of gravity. Okay. Fine. Good, other questions, comments, thoughts? Okay, so now what we want to do is to move on to a discussion of four-point amplitude. Okay, so we're going to move on to a discussion of what's called Veneziano amplitude, which is actually the first mathematical formula in string theory that was ever written down before string theory. And you get to understand this beautiful formula led in part to the work that is going to be strict theory. Okay. So what we're going to do is to try to understand the scattering of
forces. So somehow there should definitely be other directions, even if you have constrained oneself to just the terms only involved in it.
Even if one has constrained oneself. But there will be connection to all of us.
Yeah, but they don't appear in this.
They don't appear at 3 points.
At 3 points.
Yeah. We've only calculated 3 points. Yeah. the three-point scattering amplitude classically is exactly equal to that. There's no further direction. Of course, even the three-point scattering amplitude is the most would get correct quantum mechanics, not to take a couple of
loops. Yeah, so is this the most general thing that you can write on?
No, this isn't the most general thing one could. Well, oh, you're asking just. Just from a word. Okay, maybe it is the most general thing. Yeah, you see, anything with more Fs would necessarily contribute only at. Say you have four Fs, the lean dollar contribution will be F. Yes, maybe it is the most basically.
No, I mean, do we get any constraint at all from C3?
Well,
there's
coefficient.
Yeah, but okay, that is alpha prime. I mean, if you get
some square root 3 times alpha prime. I mean, it's written. Okay, now in the superstring, when we do this, the same thing in superstring, many terms that could appear wrong. Okay? But you can understand a lot of that from constraints coming from superstring. From space time transformation. Okay? But certainly, if you were just looking at things without looking carefully at supersymmetry, many terms that could appear in it. Yeah, the Bosonic string is much less constrained. But of course, you know, string, any string, including the Bosonic string, gives you a particular answer. All coefficients are particularly determined, something particular. So, there's a lot of constraints. This is the answer.
Yeah, but at this point, I can take whatever the coefficient, I can define it. From three point. So, I mean, if you leave relations between this and other things.
Yes. But you have one freedom to define, and then the next time the ratio will be complete. Okay, good. All right, we've got Amod's colloquium kind of coming up. But let's miss the introduction. Okay. Let's quickly move on to the 4 points. The 4 point tachyon. Okay. So, now, the 4 point amplitude, as you remember from our study of closed strings, is interesting because the first time in a calculation of a scattering amplitude, we have to do an integral. It's not just like another number, we have to do an integral. Right? Because, on the virtual, I mean, because you can fix three of the four vertex operators, but the fourth one is whatever it is. Okay. So, let's set up the calculation for that. Okay, so we've got, let's say, four vertex operators, it's pi k1 dot x, which is lambda 1, it's pi k2 dot x, it's lambda 2, and so on. Lambda 3, lambda 4. Okay. Now, I won't try to keep I'll take it for granted that from formal reasoning, we can set those 3 points to be wherever we want, and set them to three convenient places. Then we set them to y1 equals 0, y2 equals 1, y3 equals 0. Okay? So, what do we get? So, firstly, of course, we have product over this yi case from C's we have y12, y13, y14, y23, y24, y. This is become better than C's. Okay. Now, anything that does not involve y4 is just some number. So the only the term that involves y4 is that y14, y24, y3 form. And then there are some numbers. The numbers are like y1 minus y2 just is 1. But anything involving y3 gives infinity. You have infinity to the power of 2. What is it to the power of 3? Okay, so that's this is also infinity. It's infinity to the power. You know, more precisely, it's y3 to the power 3 is the limit of y3 to the power 3. Okay? Now let's see what we get from the momentum contractions. From the momentum contractions we have e to the pi k1 dot x and so on. We call this product of pi and x, right? We've got e to the power 2 alpha prime ki dot kj. from the point. Now let's see what ki.kj is. What this ki.kj is this? Sorry, yij.
Y12 that we don't care about. There's a Y4
into k1 dot k4 2 alpha. And y 4 minus 1 into k1 dot k2 dot k4 in alpha. Okay, now let me give you some time. Okay, our usual definition, S is equal to k1 plus k2 the whole thing squared with a minus sign. And let me defer from Polchinski to find a non-dimensionalized alpha prime. Okay, alpha prime t is equal to minus k1 plus k3 squared, and alpha prime u is equal to minus k1 plus k4. Okay, now then this object is k1 dot k4 is equal to 2k1 dot k4 with an alpha prime is equal to alpha prime k1 plus k4 the whole thing squared minus k1 squared minus k4 squared. Alpha prime is equal to minus u minus 2. Okay, so that object there is, so our final, our answer involves the piece dy4 y4 to the power minus u minus 2 y4 minus 1 to the power. And then this will be similar, except we have s, so minus s. Okay. So that's the kind of integral we have to do. If you want to solve this problem. Okay. Now, one last thing, we stop at word. This y4 is integrated over what? It's integrated from minus infinity. But, you see, the three ranges, what's really important is what? We have y1, y2, y3 inserted as 0, 1, infinity in this order. And the integral here from, in this range, from 0 to 1, will give us the same answer as the integral here from 1 to infinity, just because we couldn't parameterize this at 0 and this. The only invariant thing is what order the various vertex operators are inserted. Okay? So instead of regarding this integral as going from minus infinity to infinity, we can think of it as three different integrals, one from each of the ranges, minus infinity to 0, 0 to 1, and 1 to infinity. And the path that is from minus infinity to 0 will give us the same answer as 1 to 0 to 1, providing the interchange vertex operators is appropriate. Is this clear? So, actually there are six different contributions, each of which is proportional to a very similar integral with some interchange vertex operators. You see, what we've got is, so the six different contributions are the following. y4 here, or y1, y2, y3, and y4 here. Or y1, y2, y3, and y4 here. That's three, but y1, y2, y3 we chose a particular cyclic order. We could have had y1, y3, y2, and y4. y1, y3, y4, and y2. Okay? And y1, y2, y3, and y4. So, we allow y4 to go in this range in each of these diagrams, and each of them will give us an integral from 1 to sort of 0 to 1 with the appropriate vertex operators different. Okay. So, what are we claiming, and it will happen in the next time before I properly justify this and give you the answer, is that the answer is a sum of 6 different terms, each of which is an integral of this form. From 0 to 1. different terms itself, and K1 dot, you see, we have K1 dot K4 here, and K2 dot K4 in these two integrals, because we were going, Y4 was going between 1 and 2. So K1 dot K4, K4 and K2 dot K4. When Y4 goes between 2 and 3, this would be replaced by K2 dot K4 and K3 dot K4. Okay? And then we have to write down what each of these is in terms of these SCUs. Okay? So, we're going to get six different integrals, each of which is the same form, but with different SCUs. Now, the other thing to remember is that by the variable change, y4 equals to y4 minus 1, or 1 minus y4, we flip this term and this term. So, this is symmetric in the interchange of S and U, or the interchange of 1 and U. So, it doesn't matter what order this is. It's just given by a choice of U and S. Okay. So the three kinematic invariants, S, T, and U. Okay? And we get six terms, two of which will have S and U, two of which will have S and T, two of which will have T and U. And what we have to do is the thing is to carefully keep track of which diagram gives which dependence, so that we keep track of the lambda. Let's write it out. Okay. You see, what is this? This guy we've already seen is 1 and 4, which is U, and 1 and 2, which is 4 and 2, 4 and 2, which is the same as 1 and 3. Yes, why did I write it? This was what we. Yeah, this is what we. Okay, U and T. Okay, what about this guy? This guy will give us 2 and 4, which is the same as 1 and 3 plus T, and 4 and 3, which is the same as 1 S. This guy will give us 4 and 1, so that's U, and 4 and 1, that's U, and 4 and 3, that's S. Because that's 1 and 2. Okay. This has Y4, Y1, Y3. So Y4, Y1 is U and S. This has Y4, Y2, the same as 1 and 3, so that's T. And Y4, Y3 is S. Okay, and here, so y4, y3, which is S, and y4, y1, which is U. Okay, so we've got two SUs, two TSs. Oh, we've made some. How many SUs? Let's do this again. Y4 and y1, which is U, y4 and y3, which is S. This first. Y4 and Y3 is S, and Y4 and Y1, which is U, and this one was.
I think that should be Y3.
This is 2 and 3, right? Yeah. Right, 3 and 2. Sorry. So, this one is Y1 and Y4, which is U, and Y4 and Y2, which is T. Okay, now we've got two SUs, two STs. You messed up so badly. So,
one and four is a U.
One and four is a U, yes.
So then that's a U.
This one is a U?
Five.
Yes.
No.
One and four is a U.
One.
UT. UT. Okay. Do we have two UTs? UT, UT. We have two STs, ST, ST, and two USs. Okay, it's probably. Okay. found some, whatever this is, as A of, you know, ST. We'll figure out what A of ST is. So this thing is multiplied by what? Trace of, now we look at those that give us ST. So ST and ST. So lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 4, lambda 3, plus lambda 1, lambda 4, no, what is it? Lambda 3, lambda 4, lambda 2. Just the cyclical ordering for the two diagrams to give us this. Okay? Plus A of UT. And then the cyclical ordering for the two diagrams will give us UT. So UT are these two. So we get 1, 4, 2, 3. Plus 1, 3, 2, 4. Plus A of SU, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, plus SU, 1, 4, 3. Okay, we continue next time. Probably have to derive it against the system. Actually, Polchinski has it wrong, actually. Just an example. Nice up on me. In the system. Okay, we should just head to a more colloquial. We'll continue next class. Yeah, there are many things we want to talk about.